Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. A hearty welcome to each and every one of you, my dear brothers and sisters. Let us share the word of God and let us receive life from the word of God. For our reflection today, we have this text from Matthew's Gospel and chapter 11, verses 11 to 15. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 11 and verses 11 to 15. Truly I tell you, among those born of women, no one has risen greater than John the Baptist. Yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John came. And if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. Let anyone with ears listen. This is the passage, my dear brothers and sisters, we are going to understand today. Maybe many a times you have heard this passage. And Jesus telling his disciples, I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist. Yes, John the Baptist, son of Elizabeth and Zechariah. And we all know that Elizabeth is the cousin of Mother Mary. So which means John the Baptist and Jesus, they are the cousins. In our understanding, according to the worldly relationship. But that is not what is important, my dear brothers and sisters. Elizabeth was not able to bear children. But then it was the divine intervention that brought grace upon her. And John the Baptist was born to her and to Zechariah. And we read in Luke's Gospel chapter 1 and verse 15 about the birth of John the Baptist. And it is written in Luke's Gospel chapter 1 verse 13 and the following. The angel said to him, said to Zechariah, do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you will name him John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He must never drink wine or strong drink. Even before his birth, he will be filled with the Holy Spirit. So this is already foretold about John the Baptist, even much before his birth. He will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, when John the Baptist was born, there was real rejoicing. But what was the purpose behind his birth? What was the purpose God had to bring John the Baptist into existence? Why the word of God is telling us he must never drink wine or strong drink? Why the word of God is telling us even before his birth he will be filled with the Holy Spirit? Now last week we reflected on that text, Matthew's Gospel and chapter 3 verse 4. Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. He lived a very, very simple life. He lived a very austere life. And he prepared himself. And that's why he said, Jesus said in today's gospel that we heard, I tell you, among those born of women, no one has risen greater than John the Baptist. Yet, the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, God spoke to his people through his prophets. And we read it in Hebrews. Letter to Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 1 will tell us, long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways. From the beginning, long ago, much before Jesus was born, from the very beginning of the creation, long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. So God appointed prophets. Who are the prophets? Prophets are the people or the servants God chose to carry out his message. We have heard the first prophet would be Moses in the book of Exodus. It was first Moses was called by God and he was sent to his people in Egypt. And that's what we read in Exodus chapter 3 verse 10. God is telling Moses, so come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. So it was when God met Moses on Mount Sinai. This is what God said to Moses. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. And Moses doesn't want to go. Because he says in chapter 4 verse 10, but Moses said to the Lord, O my Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor even now, that you have spoken to your servant. But I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. So he is giving an excuse that he cannot go and speak for God. But my dear brothers and sisters, God filled him with his grace, God filled him with his spirit, and gave him the courage and conviction to go and face Pharaoh. But as his mouthpiece, the Lord said to Aaron, go with Moses. We read in Exodus chapter 4 verse 27. The Lord said to Aaron, go into the wilderness to meet Moses. So he went and he met him at the mountain of God and kissed him. And Moses told all things. Moses told Aaron all the words of the Lord with which he had sent him and all the signs with which he had charged him. So Aaron is sent with Moses as his mouthpiece. So Aaron is speaking for Moses and Moses has stood for God. So they are chosen by God and they are sent by God in order to deliver his people from the hands of the Pharaoh. So from that time, my dear brothers and sisters, God has been sending prophets. God has been appointing or choosing the prophets. And that's how we have so many prophets. Prophet Isaiah, Prophet Jeremiah, Prophet Ezekiel, Prophet Daniel, Prophet Joel, Elijah, Elisha. There's so many of them. And it was said before the coming of Jesus, once again Elijah would come and prepare the way for Jesus. That's what is meant in this passage that we just now heard. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John came. Matthew chapter 11 and verse 13. All the prophets and the law prophesied until John came. And if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. But we read in Mark's Gospel chapter 9 and verse 11 and the following. So before the coming of the Savior, Elijah is again to come and prepare the way for the Savior. And that was what was foretold in Mark's Gospel chapter 9 verses 9 onwards till 13. This entire passage is about the coming of Elijah. Then they asked him, why do the scribes say that Elijah must come first? So the disciples are asking Jesus, the scribes, the scholars, why do they say that Elijah must come first? Then he said to them, Elijah is indeed coming first to restore all things. And Jesus also agreed that yes, Elijah is going to come first. Why is he going to come? Because to restore all things. How then is it written about the Son of Man that he is to go through many sufferings and be treated with contempt? But then Jesus said, but I tell you that Elijah has come, and they did to him whatever they pleased, as it is written about him. So when Jesus is speaking to his disciples, he tells them that Elijah has already come. What was foretold by the prophets, that before the coming of Jesus or before the coming of the Savior, Elijah has to come once again. And Jesus says, Elijah has come. So who is this Elijah who has already come just before Jesus? In today's passage, Jesus makes it clear. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John came. And if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. So John the Baptist is Elijah who is to come. And who has already come. And that's why in our last reflection we heard him saying, prepare the way of the Lord. Very clearly we understood, prepare the way of the Lord. The Lord has come. The kingdom of God is at hand. Prepare the way of the Lord. So John the Baptist prepared people to receive Jesus. Though at the birth of Jesus, in Luke's Gospel, we read the shepherds, the angels, all of them came to know the birth of the Savior. But then soon after the birth, I think everyone forgot. As in Luke's Gospel chapter 2, verse 10 and the following, we read about the announcement of the birth of Jesus. Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, verse 10 and the following. The angel said to them, do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. So at the birth of Jesus, the angels announced the good news. And they went and gave the good news to the shepherds. But soon after the birth of Jesus, till he was 12 years old, we don't see anyone accepting him or following him or speaking about him as Savior. Again, Jesus comes into the picture when he was 12 years old, when he was lost in the temple. And after that incident, again we do not know what has happened to Jesus from age 12 to 30. And then comes John the Baptist. Yes, he comes to prepare the way of the Lord. That's what we heard in Matthew's Gospel chapter 3. In the wilderness. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming. So he's proclaiming the coming of the Lord in the wilderness. Telling people, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said. So Isaiah, prophet Isaiah had already foretold about the coming of Jesus. Coming of the Savior, the Redeemer. But his instant coming was announced, or the preparation for his real coming was made by John the Baptist. Again, recalling those prophecies, reminding people of those promises which God made through the prophets. And that's why he's quoting Isaiah and saying, this is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, the voice of the one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. So Isaiah also had foretold about John the Baptist, who is going to shout in the wilderness, who is going to cry out in the wilderness, telling people, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And that's why Jesus is telling, my dear brothers and sisters, in today's passage that we heard, all the prophets and also the law prophesied about the coming of the Savior. And all the prophets and the law prophesied before the coming of the Savior, the Redeemer, Elijah would come once again. So people are still, some of the people even now are still waiting for Elijah. For example, just 3 weeks ago, a woman came and told me, Father, it is written, before the coming of the Lord, Elijah has to come. So before the second coming of Jesus, Elijah would come again. But that sister has not understood this text, my dear brothers and sisters. Elijah has already come. And who is that Elijah? Jesus very clearly says, and if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. Who is Elijah? John the Baptist is the Elijah. He has come already. He has prepared the way for Jesus. And that's why much before the birth of Jesus, John the Baptist prepared people to receive him. Much before Jesus began his public ministry, John gathered the people to accept him. And that's why he gave that baptism of the water as a sign of repentance to all those who were ready to receive him. And he prophesied saying, in Matthew chapter 3 verse 11, I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. So he's already preparing for Jesus, saying, I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. So this is a preparation already John the Baptist making for the coming of the Lord. And today also, my dear brothers and sisters, people are not accepting the prophets of God. And that's why Jesus said in Mark 9 and verse 13, yes, he has come, but they treated him very badly. But I tell you that Elijah has come, and they did to him whatever they pleased, as it is written about him. The prophets were not accepted. Even Jesus was not accepted in his own town, in his own hometown. And John the Baptist, he was not accepted. But he had to do his mission. He had to do his vocation, the call for which he was chosen. To announce, to prepare the way of the Lord. And Jesus said, Elijah who is to come has already come. And therefore, let anyone who has ears listen. So, my dear brothers and sisters, we have to understand the truth that it was John the Baptist who prepared for the coming of the Lord. And it was John the Baptist who is that Elijah was to come before Jesus was to come. And that's why in John's Gospel, when Jesus was coming towards John, this is what he said in John's Gospel chapter 1 and verse 29. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So looking at Jesus, John the Baptist is making this announcement. Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And the prophecy is fulfilled. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me. Very clear, my dear brothers and sisters. Let no one confuse you. Let no one take you astray with their own imagination. There are so many people speak out of imagination, not out of revelation. We listen to so many preachers, you just listen to them, they are speaking from their imagination. And not the revelation that has come through the Holy Spirit. So when the revelation has come to you, the word of God will support you. And that word of God will prove the revelation that you have received. And here very clearly John the Baptist says, "This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me." Very clearly John the Baptist is speaking about the Savior, the Redeemer, Jesus. And very clearly this situation tells us that he is that prophet. He is that Elijah who was to come before Jesus to prepare the way of the Lord. And further he says, "I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." Very clear. So John the Baptist was sent before Jesus to prepare the way. He came to baptize the people with water as their sign of repentance, so that he might be revealed to Israel. And again, John the Baptist, the greatest prophet among all the prophets, he testified saying, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." So this is the truth, my dear brothers and sisters. "I myself have seen," says John the Baptist, "and have testified that this is the Son of God." So we have no doubt to accept John the Baptist as the greatest among all the prophets. We have no doubt to accept John the Baptist as the Elijah who was to come before Jesus. Yes, it was John the Baptist who prepared the way for the Lord. But yet Jesus says, "Yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." Though John the Baptist is the greatest among all the prophets, Jesus says, yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist. Which means, in heaven, even if you are not a prophet, even if you are not a priest, even if you are not a chosen, if you have humbled yourself, yes, the one who is in the kingdom of God, the least among all those who are in the kingdom of God, they are the greatest, or they are greater than John the Baptist, Jesus says. Which means, in heaven, my dear brothers and sisters, we will be able to attain that glory which God has promised. We will be able to experience the greatness which we cannot imagine here on earth. And therefore, John the Baptist came to announce the coming of the Lord, and also he came to prepare us to experience that kingdom of God. So when we listen to the word, when we accept the word, when we accept the word of the prophets and live according to the word, we inherit the kingdom of God, and we can experience that greatness, which is much more than the greatness here on earth. So the Lord is inviting you and me to prepare ourselves to receive that kingdom by accepting Jesus as our Lord, as our Savior. Yes, may all those who have listened to me today, yes, without doubt, accept the word as truth, accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, so that you will experience his kingdom here on earth. And there in heaven, yes, you will be crowned with his glory. May the Lord bless you and fulfill all his promises in your life. God bless you. Amen. Jesus said, "Ask and it will be given to you. Search and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened for you." Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, every Friday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m., we gather in our Trinity Home Cardinal Mulki for intercession. We pray for all your needs and intentions with faith in Jesus. we welcome you to join us with your prayer intentions. Let us pray together and seek God's help for all our needs. Come with your family. Remember, every Friday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. in our Trinity home, Karnal, Mulki.
Father God, you're there beside me.